All right. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Crossroads. My name is Jeff, one of the pastors here. And I got to tell you, I hope you're more excited to study the Word of God than you are for Christmas. No? Yeah? Let me say that again. I hope you're excited to study the Word of God. You didn't seem very excited for Christmas when Pastor Adam asked that, but I'm fired up today because I have the privilege today of studying God's Word with you, and it's a special privilege because today we're concluding our series Endgame, but in addition to that, we're concluding our 2020 Spiritual Vision Initiative where we've been walking through the Bible from start to finish, all in a goal to better understand the overarching picture of Scripture. And today we come to the end of the Bible, and we're going to talk about what it means to finally be home one day. All right, little audience participation. You guys are going to have to play along here, okay? Those of you at home, do it as well, please. Raise your hand if you believe heaven is real. Raise your hand if that describes you, okay? Most hands, a lot of hands going up, not surprising. About 70% of people, according to studies in America, believe that heaven is real. Second question, audience participation again. Raise your hand if you would define heaven as the ultimate destination for Christ followers. Raise your hand if that is what you would say, okay? A lot of hands going up. I'm guessing there's a lot of hands going up at home as well. What if I told you you were wrong? What if I told you that heaven, as most of us envision it, is not our final destination? What if I told you that God has an even better destination in mind for His children? Would that intrigue you? I sure hope so, because today we're going to look at what it looks like for believers to finally be home. Today we're going to look at the new heavens and the new earth, because that is the ultimate destination for God's people. Let's face it, we live in a society of instant gratification. We live in a society of extreme material comfort. We're often way more concerned about our investments and our retirement packages and our future on this earth than we are about God's ultimate end game for His people. Which is wildly concerning when you consider the fact that just about everything that's precious to us will one day be found in the new heavens and the new earth. Yet we often settle for nothing more than shallow and passing thoughts on what's going to happen to us one day. I'm praying that changes today, because we're going to use insights from scholars like Wayne Grudem and David Platt, Randy Alcorn, and David Jeremiah, just to name a few. And as we provide an overview of this incredible destination that God has dreamed up for His people, for some of you, I believe this is going to serve as a massive, really needed encouragement. And for others of you, I won't soft sell it. I believe it's going to be an uncomfortable warning. But please, let the Spirit of God do the work that He wants to do in your heart wherever you're at, because by the end today, I promise you that we will all know what it means and what it takes to be finally home one day. We've got a ton to work through today, as evidenced by your two-page outline, okay? So let's dive right in. Define heaven. We're going to define heaven in the most basic sense as this. Heaven is seen as the place where God dwells. It's seen as the place where God dwells. And this most basic understanding of heaven is where most Christ followers tend to stop. Christians often talk about living with God forever in heaven. But in fact, the biblical teaching is far richer than that. And so to properly define heaven, we're going to go deeper, and I want to do a deeper dive, and I want to give you two additional terms to help define heaven. The first term we're going to go with is immediate heaven. It's the place where God's people dwell with Him following death while awaiting their bodily resurrection. Immediate heaven is the place where God's people dwell with Him following death while awaiting their bodily resurrection. Now, many theologians call this the intermediate heaven, but I like how one scholar noted, he said that words like interim and intermediate, they sort of imply an incompleteness, and I tend to agree. It sort of gives this idea that when we die and go to heaven, that it's a place that pales in comparison to the real place. And that's not the case at all. Heaven's incredible. Immediate heaven may not be the final place where we'll live with God forever, but when a Christ follower experiences death on this earth, Scripture makes clear that while our bodies, the bodies of believers, go into the ground awaiting their resurrection from the dead, the souls of deceased believers go immediately into the very presence of God, which is by definition incredible. The Apostle Paul speaks of that in 2 Corinthians 5, verse 6 and 8. He said, "Therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord." Verse 8, "We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord." So Paul's speaking to the fact that to be away from the body, which is a reference to death, is to be at home with the Lord, which is a reference to being in God's presence. The implication is that at death, the soul of a believer immediately enters the presence of God. So while the term immediate heaven is not one that you're going to find in Scripture, it's clear that upon death, Christ followers go there immediately and are with God, and that's indeed heaven. But that's not the end of the story. It gets even better for Christ's followers, because after the final judgment, which Pastor Nick talked about last week, here's what the Apostle John tells us is going to happen next. In Revelation 21, verses 1 through 5, I want you to listen to this. Then John said, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away.' He was seated on the throne and said, 'I am making everything new.' Then he said, 'Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true.'" In John's vision of events to follow the final judgment, he sees the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God. And then John hears that voice proclaiming that God's dwelling place is now among the people. I hope you didn't miss that. "And he will dwell with them, and they will be his people." So John is speaking to a time that is yet to come when there will be a joining of heaven and earth in this new creation. And there we will live in the presence of God, which then brings us back to our goal of defining heaven. The first term I gave you was immediate heaven. What John is referring to here is I love what David Platt, he calls it, the eternal heaven, which is the new heavens and new earth, where God will dwell with his people in unhindered and in unimaginable joy. Eternal heaven is that new heavens and new earth where God's going to dwell with his people. Now, I've listed a bunch of additional verses in your outline today that also speak to this new heavens and new earth. The point that I want you to get for today is this. Okay, don't miss this. The immediate heaven is going to be amazing, and it's not even the end of the story. It gets even better for Christ followers, because our ultimate destination, our ultimate end game, is that we will live in the new heavens and new earth where we will reign with Christ. That is the eternal heaven. That is the glorious future for the people of God. So, let's put it all together in an overview, okay? That means when a believer dies, our soul goes immediately into the presence of God forever, but we await Christ's return, his second coming, because it's only after his return that we will experience bodily resurrection. At that time, Jesus will set up his millennial kingdom, after which there will be a final judgment of all believers and unbelievers. And then God will usher in the new heavens and the new earth. And it's there where we believers will live as resurrected beings on the resurrected earth forever with our God. Therefore, as Platt notes, this is cool. The ultimate end of the gospel is not that heaven's going to come to us. It's not that we'll go to heaven. It's that heaven's going to come to us. It's not that we're going to go to heaven. The ultimate end of the gospel is that heaven's going to come to us. I just want you to ponder that for a moment, friends. God not only made a way for us to experience forgiveness and eternal life with Him, but one day He promises to bring heaven to us. What an incredible, what a gracious God we serve. Amen? The new heavens, the new earth, that is the ultimate end game for God's people, for believers. And contrary to what people think, it's not a place where we've got nothing better to do but float on clouds, dressed in white robes, playing harps. We're talking about a physical place. It's not a state of mind. We're talking about a new earth where we have everything to do. We've got a God to worship, a kingdom to rule, a universe to explore, work to accomplish, and friends to enjoy. This new heavens and new earth is the final, the fantastic destination for God's people. And I want all of us to leave today with a greater appreciation for what awaits us if we've been born again into the family of this God who dreamt up this end game for His people. And to do that, I want to quickly highlight four things that believers can expect in the new heavens and new earth. The first of which is renewed creation with extraordinary beauty. Renewed creation with extraordinary beauty. Several passages indicate that the physical creation will be renewed in a significant way, one of which is Romans 8, verses 19 to 21, where the Apostle Paul says this. Catch this, okay? He says, "For the creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the freedom and the glory of the children of God." Way back in Genesis chapter 3, we studied the fall of mankind as Adam and Eve ushered sin into the world. And as a result of that fall, every part of God's creation was subjected to the curse. The ground was cursed for Adam's sake, where thorns and thistles and weeds would grow instead. All women who've followed Eve have labored painfully in childbirth as a result of the curse. And worst of all, by far, the curse brought the entrance of death into our world. In Romans 8:21, Paul explains that all creation is held under the curse. And it too, listen to this, creation longs for the day when it will join with the children of God in liberation from death and decay. Paul's speaking of the new heavens and the new earth when the curse of sin will be lifted once and for all. And all of creation will be restored to that Eden-like reflection of God's glory. And listen, this shouldn't surprise us because let's not forget, the Bible doesn't start in Genesis chapter 3, right? The Bible starts in Genesis chapter 1 with paradise in the magnificent and beautiful Garden of Eden. And Paul's saying here, hey, God's going to restore the earth to that paradise again. Now, within the Protestant world, there's disagreement among scholars as to whether the earth is going to be completely destroyed and replaced or whether it's going to just simply be drastically changed and renewed. Personally, I tend to side with scholars like Grudem who argue that the present sin-distorted creation is going to be so incredibly renewed that it will be as if God had made it brand new. It seems unlikely to me that God would completely destroy His creation that He once listed as being what? Very good. I like what Randy Alcorn says about this issue. This is a great quote. He said, "God doesn't throw away His handiwork and start from scratch. Instead, He uses the same canvas to repair and make more beautiful the painting marred by the vandal. The vandal doesn't get the satisfaction of destroying his rival's masterpiece. On the contrary, God makes an even greater masterpiece out of what His enemy sought to destroy." Boy, does that not apply to our lives as well? Amen? That what Satan tries to destroy, God says, no. No, you won't have them. I've got bigger plans for their life. So clearly Alcorn holds that God's going to dramatically renew the creation and the original earth that he created. Our goal is not to solve that debate today, because regardless of the view that you hold to, the point is that the gospel is far greater than we might even understand. It's not just good news for us. Man, the gospel is good news for animals and plants and mountains and stars and the sky and the earth in general. I've listed additional scriptures in your outline for you to look at in your own time that speak more to this. But what you're going to see over and over again is that scripture consistently portrays this new creation as a place of extraordinary beauty where God's people will live forever. Now listen, I want you to do something with me. I want you to take a feeble shot at trying to just imagine what this new creation is going to be like. So I'm going to ask you right now to close your eyes, and if you're like, oh, it's lame, I don't want to do that, do it anyway, please, okay? Just close your eyes right now and think about the most beautiful place you have seen on this earth. Think about it right now. Get it in your mind, that place that pops to mind, pops to your heart right now. Now imagine being able to enjoy that place without the effects of sin lingering in the background. Imagine being able to enjoy it without worrying about your child who's really hurting right now. Imagine being able to enjoy it without the stress of having to get home to work to just pay bills. Imagine enjoying that creation. You see it? Imagine enjoying it without that scary health prognosis that's waiting for you when you get back to your normal life. Imagine being able to enjoy it without having to worry about the loss of that loved one, crying tears of sadness for that person you're missing so badly. Friends, our earth is a beautiful place, but we have not seen anything yet. Just wait till God reverses the curse and he renews the creation as part of the new heavens and new earth. That's the first thing you can expect. Let me give you a second thing believers can expect in the new heavens and new earth. We can expect physical activity and resurrection bodies. We can expect physical activity and resurrection bodies. Some of you are thinking, what in the world's a resurrection body? I mentioned this earlier, that at the second coming of Christ, that's when the souls of all believers throughout human history will be reunited with their bodies all at the same time. It's going to be incredible, right? But these aren't just our current bodies with a few blemishes and flaws touched up, okay? This isn't like putting on our Iron Man suit and counting it as an upgrade. We're talking about a complete transformation where God clothes us with a body that is suited for eternity. Remember, death is an abnormal condition because it tears apart what God created to be joined together. God intended for our bodies to last as long as our souls, but sin and its effects changed all of that. So at the second coming of Christ, God's going to undo the effects of sin, and we're going to receive new resurrection bodies that will reunite with our souls for eternity. Now, there are a number of passages that speak to the issue of Christ followers being raised from the dead. But in 1 Corinthians, using an agricultural example of sowing a seed in the ground and then watching it grow into something far more wonderful, the Apostle Paul goes on to explain in great detail what our resurrection bodies look like. In chapter 15, he says this in verses 42 to 44. So will it be with the resurrection of the dead. The body that is sown is perishable, it's raised imperishable. It's sown in dishonor, it's raised in glory. It's sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. So contrary to our current bodies, which wear out or grow old or are subject to disease and sickness, Paul says our new bodies, they will be imperishable, they will be glorious, and they will be powerful. Our new bodies will be completely healthy and strong forever. The evidence of physical ailments that we face in this life, it will be gone. And when Paul says that our resurrection bodies are raised a spiritual body, he's not saying that we're going to lack material form or substance. That would be contrary to what he's saying in the whole passage. What he's saying is that our resurrection bodies are going to be bodies that are completely subject to the Holy Spirit and responsive to the Holy Spirit's guidance. In Philippians 3:21, Paul spoke to how incredible these resurrection bodies will be when he said this. Jesus, will take our mortal bodies and change them into glorious bodies like his own. So Paul says our resurrection bodies are going to be like the body Jesus had after he rose from the dead. That's a really powerful statement. And the new heavens and the new earth will be a place where we live forever clothed in these bodies. Listen, I don't want you to miss this, okay? We might not have all the details of exactly how it plays out, but Scripture indicates that we're going to have activities for our bodies to do, such as worship and serve and eat and drink and rest, but we're not going to have to do those things just to live anymore. That's not the deal. We're going to recognize one another. We're going to spend time fellowshipping with one another, and we're not just going to do that with people who look like us. There will be believers from every tribe, every tongue, every nation that occupy the new heavens and new earth. It will be a place of beautiful diversity. And it will be a place where our bodies never break down, fail, or succumb to death. You know, I want so badly to make sure this sinks in today for all of us. Because again, we're not talking about floating on clouds all day. We're going to exist in renewed physical bodies on this renewed earth. And that's great news for all of us. Because listen, there are believers listening to this right now who have significant physical disabilities in this life. And one day, God's going to clothe you with a body free of those debilitating challenges. And man, you're going to run and you're going to jump in ways that maybe you never thought you could or could do in this life. Others of you, you've lost children way too soon. As I typed this sermon, I thought about some of you, some of my friends, and my eyes just welled up with tears as I thought about how some of you might have that image of your child's lifeless body, and I can only imagine what that must be like. But one day that image will be changed forever. One day as believers, you're going to be reunited with your believing child, and you're going to walk with them, and you're going to hold hands with them, and you're going to sing with them in the new heavens and the new earth. Some of you have lost parents like my wife and I have, and One day, you're going to see them again in a body free from pain. One day, my wife's mental image of her father being unable to move due to inoperable brain cancer, it's going to get replaced as she dances again with her dad in the new heavens and new earth, just like she did at our wedding. Physical activity and resurrection bodies is something that all believers can look forward to with hope in the new heavens and new earth. Let me give you a third thing that believers can expect in the new heavens and new earth. We can expect unhindered fellowship with God. Unhindered fellowship with God. More important than the beauty and the fellowship and the freedom from pain and suffering, more important than all of these things by far, will be the fact that we will be in the presence of Almighty God, enjoying unhindered fellowship with Him. Look back at Revelation 21:3. This time we're going to read from the New American Standard Translation. John said, "And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the tabernacle,'" underline that, "'of God is among the people, and he will dwell among them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be among them." So here the new heavens and the new earth is likened to the tabernacle, right? That's the tent where God would dwell with his people in the New Testament. Don't miss this, guys. God's intention from the beginning was to enjoy fellowship with people like us. That led to him creating the human race in the first place, then to his dwelling in the tabernacle and the temple, then to Jesus coming to dwell amongst us as God in the flesh, and the final stage in God's plan to have unbroken fellowship with his people is when he comes and lives amongst his people in the new heavens and the new earth. And John says this about that time in Revelation 22, verses 3 and 4. "No longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants will serve him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. John notes that the curse seen in Genesis will be reversed. And the new heavens and the new earth, it'll be a place of perfect reconciliation with God. All evil, all sin, all suffering, all of the debilitating effects of sin will have been reversed. And verse 4 speaks to what will be our greatest joy. Seeing God face to face and being in his presence forever. As we gaze into the face of the God who created us and who saved us, Psalm 16, verse 11 is going to become more real than it's ever been in this life. You will make known to me the way of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. In your right hand, there are pleasures forever. When we finally see the Lord in heaven face to face, our always restless, rarely satisfied hearts will want nothing else. And this unhindered access to God and fellowship with him, that's the permanent state of believers alongside God as he rules the new heaven and new earth that we occupy with him. How incredible is that? I am honestly not sure that we fully comprehend how amazing this truly is. Because in this life, we experience the presence of God through the filter of those sinful urges that are always tugging at our heart. I mean, how else would you explain the fact that we often ignore our need for God's presence, our need to be in worship on Sunday mornings, our need to be in the Word of God, our need to be praying? But one day, we'll see him face to face. And we're going to know that he's an intimate, personal God whose love for us cannot even be comprehended. In God's face, we're going to see the fulfillment of that longing in all of our hearts for perfect love, for perfect peace, for perfect joy. We're going to be in the presence of the all-powerful, all-knowing, always-present God, and yet he's going to look at us as a loving father, and he's going to welcome his kids to just enjoy his presence at all times. Listen, I want to tell you something. This is not just a feel-good story for Christians to get through life. If you think that, you are dead wrong. This is the glorious future of all people who trust in Christ Jesus as their Savior in this life. Now, there's a bunch more that I could say about what we can expect in a new heavens and new earth, but in the interest of time, I'm going to cap it off by giving you a fourth one really quickly. Here's the fourth thing you can expect. You can expect the restoration of all things. The restoration of all things. This point should be pretty clear by now. But what we're talking about today, it's not just a tweaking about how things go in this life, okay? What we're talking about is a total restoration of all we know and all we experience. Paul explains it this way in Ephesians 1, verse 10. He said this, and this is the plan. At the right time, he will bring everything, God will bring everything under the authority of Christ, everything in heaven and on earth. Christ will make heaven into earth and earth into heaven. God's plan of the ages is to bring everything in heaven and earth under the authority of his son Jesus. And notice, I don't miss the continuity between God's renewed plan and his original plan. Watch this. In Genesis, God creates humans and he places them in a beautiful garden and he calls it Eden. In Revelation, God brings heaven down to earth, puts a garden in the middle and he calls it the new earth. And in between is the story of the curse of sin and its effects on mankind and our attempts to overcome it. But only that victory, the only way it could be earned was through what Jesus did on the cross. And once that victory was earned, once Jesus gave his life on the cross, now things can be different. In Eden, there is no sin or pain or death or curse. On the new earth, there is no more sin or pain or death or curse. In Genesis, the Redeemer's promised. In Revelation, the Redeemer returns. In Genesis, it's the story of paradise lost. In Revelation, it's the story of paradise regained. This is the unstoppable plan of God, friends. This is where history's headed. This is where every believer's going, that to a new heaven and new earth that God has made possible by the power of our living God. Amen? Now, that's a solid doctrinal overview for you. But we always want to consider how what we're learning can apply to how we live. So I want to pivot. I want to spend a little bit of time looking at three things that the promise of the new heavens and a new earth should produce in the lives of Christ's followers. The first of which is a commitment to holiness. It should produce a commitment to holiness. When we consider the fact that this present creation, that it's a temporary one, and that our life in the new creation will be one where we spend eternity, well, we've got strong motivation for living lives of godliness and holiness that God uses for eternal impact. This includes in our purity. It includes in the area of our purity. Are we living our daily lives in such a way that God can use us for eternal impact? Or is there secret sin tucked away that's holding us back? Are we selectively choosing what parts of God's word we're going to pay attention to and which parts we're going to ignore? Have we been spiritually backsliding pretty much since March when this whole COVID thing blew up? Are we living as hypocrites where we're one person on a Sunday and a totally different person on a Monday? Whatever it might be, if our hearts are stirred at the thought of spending eternity in the new heavens and the new earth, then isn't it worth making whatever changes we need to make to our daily lives so that God can use the one life we have so that more people will experience life in the new heavens and new earth just like we will? But what we're studying today also provides motivation to live out holiness in another area of our life, and that's with our possessions. That's with our possessions. Some of you are like, I don't get the connection. Let me show you. So many of us are living as if this life is where we're going to spend forever. So we spend however we want, on whatever we want, whenever we want. And so many believers ignore their command to be rich towards God and other people. Now, don't mishear me, okay? There's nothing wrong with bigger homes and newer cars and iPhone 23s or whatever that is. There's nothing wrong with having the toys and the technological gadgets that life can offer you. But boy, I'm telling you right now, friends, we would be wise to remember that you can't take any of that stuff with you when you leave this life. Not a bit of it goes with you. So the doctrine of the new heavens and new earth, but I'm telling you, it should cause each of us to evaluate how well we're using the possessions that God has entrusted to us to manage for eternal impact. What might need to change in how you handle possessions so that you better store up treasure in heaven, as Jesus said, so that you use your resources to help other people experience the new life in the new heavens and new earth like you'll experience? Okay, so the promise of the new heavens and new earth, it should produce a commitment to holiness in both purity and with our possessions. Secondly, it should produce confidence amidst hardship. It should produce confidence amidst hardship. The doctrine of the new heavens and the new earth, boy, it helps believers walk through this life with hope, doesn't it? Knowing that one day the pain and the suffering of this life will be no more. You know, I read a story this week many years back when Dr. W.A. Criswell, he was pastor of First Baptist Church in Dallas. And he shared a story of a time that he was on an airplane sitting beside and visiting with a very well-known theologian. And this theologian told Dr. Criswell the story of how his little boy had just recently died of meningitis. This is a true story. I never get through this without tearing up, so if I do, I apologize. But he told of the day that he was sitting next to his son's bedside, and his little boy said, "Daddy, it's getting dark, isn't it?" And the theologian answered, said to his son, "Yes, son, it's getting very dark." "Daddy, I guess it's time for me to go to sleep now, isn't it?" the little boy asked his dad. "Yes, son. It's time for you to go to sleep." So the little boy fixed his pillow and he put his head on his hands the way he always did. And he said, "Good night, Daddy. I'll see you in the morning." And the little boy closed his eyes and he took his last breath. And he stepped into heaven. Dr. Criswell told the story of how that day on the airplane, after the theologian told him that, he didn't say anything for a long period of time. And the man just stared out the window of that airplane. And finally, he turned to Dr. Criswell with tears just streaming down his face. And he said, "Dr. Criswell, I can hardly wait for the morning." Boy, there are a whole lot of people in our world right now, including some of you, who feel like that theologian did, that you can hardly wait for the morning. Because hardship is all over the place in our world right now. We have people dying in nursing homes and hospice without their family being able to be present. We have people watching their dreams of their small business just fall apart right now during this time. That might include some of you that are listening today. Some of you are listening today and you're in the early phases of grieving the loss of a loved one that's left a gaping hole in your life. Others of you, you're watching your children make devastating choices that are crushing your heart as a parent. Some of you have a marriage on the ropes and you just don't understand how it could possibly come back. Others of you might be grieving the loss of a miscarriage. Some of you might be students and you're wondering what your place in the world is. Some of you are students believing like, "Man, I'm too far gone. What's the point?" Others of you are feeling isolated and lonely and depressed, and that dark cloud, it never seems to leave. Undoubtedly, there's a whole lot of people who are listening right now who are in the midst of intense hardship. And if you're listening to this right now and your life's perfect, praise God for that. But listen, I'm going to tell you right now, the hardship will come your way one day. One day, that doctor report's going to be one that you will dread. One day, the loss of a loved one will be a painful reality that you're experiencing too. I don't wish that for you, but Jesus made clear this world is full of trouble and we're going to have our share of hardship. And that's why what we're studying today should be a great source of hope for all believers today. Because, listen to me, one day, something else is going to happen if you're a follower of Jesus Christ. One day, there's that morning, it's going to come, friends. One day, the curse will be lifted. One day, God's going to wipe every tear from your eyes. One day, there's going to be a new heavens and a new earth where we're going to live forever. And it's going to be a place that's characterized by laughter without tears, by life without pain, by contentment without crying, by pleasure without pain, and God will be there dwelling with us. And friend, it's my prayer, I've been praying that God would use this to give you confidence amidst whatever hardship might come your way. And again, if life's perfect for you, fantastic, but then put this in reserve, because it won't always be. All right, let me give you one more thing the promise of the new heavens and new earth should produce. And this one is so important that if you have zoned out, say it with me. What am I going to say? Zone back in. Thank you. All right, very good. That means you're still with me. It should produce a question of where you will spend eternity. It should produce a question of where you will spend eternity. The Bible tells us that God's placed a desire for eternity in all of our hearts. So listen, I'm going to be pretty blunt right now, but if this topic doesn't make you at least ask, "Do I know where I'm going to spend eternity?" then I would suggest to you something's really wrong inside. If you're zoning out right now because you're like, "I don't really care," something's not right inside. Because while life in the new heavens and the new earth forever with God in perfected resurrection bodies, in a perfect earth is one option. I don't want you to be uninformed about the other one. Revelation 21:27 speaks to the other option. Speaking of the new heavens and the new earth, John says this: "Nothing impure will ever enter it, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life." See, friends, only people whose name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life will spend forever in the presence of God in perfect paradise on this earth, in perfect resurrection bodies. and those whose names are not in the Lamb's Book of Life. I want you to hear me right now. It's not like you just cease to exist and so it's all okay. It doesn't work like that. As Pastor Nick talked about last week, there will be a final judgment for all people. And anyone whose name is not written in the Lamb's Book of Life will spend forever apart from God and will eventually join Satan and the demons in the lake of fire where eternal punishment awaits. I'm not trying to be a downer here, okay? But the most unloving thing I could do as a pastor is not warn you about that truth. Because here's the thing, listen, it's not like some puzzle that you need to figure out in order to have your name in the Lamb's Book of Life. It's not like you've got to work your way to get into it. In fact, you never could work your way into it. You could never earn it. And the way in which you become part of the Lamb's Book of Life is by choosing Jesus in this life. Jesus is the Lamb of God who was slain for you. He died to pay for your sins and mine because he loves you, because you matter to God. But I want you to hear me. Knowing this truth is not enough to have your name in the Lamb's Book of Life. That's what so many people, even people in here or listening online, you're stuck right there. You're like, yeah, I know all this stuff. Good. That's not what we're talking about today. You've got to make a decision regarding Jesus Christ. You've got to make a choice. You've got to decide that your sins are a big enough deal that you too, yeah, you need a Savior. And he came and he gave his life for you, and you need to call on him to wash your sin away and to give you new life in him, because right now, life without him isn't exactly working out for you. And when you admit that, I want you to hear me. I don't care if you think you're too far gone. I don't care if you think that your past disqualifies you. It's not true. The enemy wants you to believe that. So if that's your desire today, here's the thing. When you admit that you need him and you call on him to make you brand new and give you new life in him, God's going to send his Spirit into your life. He's going to allow you to experience his presence here and now, which is just a taste of what it's going to be like one day to live in the presence of God forever. But it's up to you. This could be the day everything changes for you. This could be the day that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Friends, only by God's grace, and because of what Jesus did for a mess like me, my name's written in that book. And I'm going to live forever with God in the new heavens and the new earth. And one day, my prayer is that we're going to have a crossroads reunion in that place of perfection when we're all finally home. Listen, I want to just have you have a chance right now to respond. For some of you, right now, you know you're not right with God. You know you don't have a saving relationship with Jesus, and your heart testifies to that, because right now your heart is screaming out, today's the day, today's the day. But then Satan's going to be whispering in the other ear saying, nah, you can wait, you can wait, you can wait. Why would you want to turn down what we just talked about today? That sounds like a pretty good thing to me. So here's the deal. If that's where you're at right now and you know you don't have a relationship with Jesus, you don't have to go figure it all out on your own. He wants you the way you are. He loves you the way you are. And he wants to start a new work in your life. He wants to do a new thing. If you'll just cry out to him and say you need me, or that you need him. So right now I want to ask you to bow your heads. We're going to go just to a time of extended response right now. We're going to turn the lights down right now, and we're just going to allow you just to do business with God. Right now, in the silence of your heart, if you're in here today and you're like, that's me, I need a relationship with Jesus, I want to know that I'm his and that I'm going to spend forever with him, even if I've prayed a prayer a million times, but today's the day that I know that I want to get right with him, simply tell him this. Say, Jesus, I know I'm a sinner, and I can't do life without you anymore. I need you, Jesus. I need you to save me. I need you to make me brand new. You're the King of all kings. And you died in my place so that I could have life. And so today, save me from my sin. Wash me clean. And I bow before you. I give you my life because you gave yours for me. And with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, if you're a believer in here right now, oh, would you celebrate in your heart right now? Would you thank God for the fact that one day, everything that's difficult in your life right now, it's going to be made new. One day, all the pain, all the sin, all the suffering, it's going to be redeemed. And can you picture it? Can you picture being in His presence with God, with none of the effects of sin? Thank Him for that right now. And if you're a believer in here right now, and you've been wildly discouraged because life's been really hard right now, oh, let the words of God, let the truth of His words just soak over you right now and declare right now in your heart that God, my hope is in you, period. I trust you. Thank you for what you have for me. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the privilege that we have to study your word. What a privilege it's been to walk through the Bible for this year together. God, thank you that from the beginning of the Bible to the end, the story is ultimately that you desire to be with us. You desire us to be with you. Thank you that you made a way to do that. Thank you that you sent your Son for us because you love us. I pray that when we walk out the doors today, when we walk out of our homes today, that we would be different as a result of that. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, friends, you could just sense the Spirit of God working in a pretty cool way today. Here's what I want you to do. I'm asking you, I'm begging you to take this step. If God's moving in your heart, maybe today you called on Christ for the first time, or maybe you called on Christ and really meant it for the first time. There's a huge difference between the two. One way, the first way, the Spirit of God's not living in your life. The second way, when you call on Christ, the Holy Spirit enters your life and changes everything. Text the word home, home, to 920-717-1715. We would love to talk with you about what it means to know where your home is eventually going to be. And if you're a believer and you just want someone to encourage you, maybe you're going through a tough time and you need to be reminded of the hope we have, please text that keyword. Otherwise, what I'm going to ask you to do is we're going to stand right now and we're going to sing and we're going to declare the praises of the great I Am as our music team comes on the stage right now. And we're going to celebrate that one day we get to be in His presence for eternity. That sounds like a pretty good deal. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the people who are worshiping today. Thank you that we get to do this together. And now, God, as we sing out, I pray that you would be glorified. We're going to sing about the fact that you are the great I Am. And I thank you that you love us enough as the great I Am to go and make a way for us to be with you one day. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.